history. This week marks the traditional commemorative date that recognizes the completion of the Septuagint, also pronounced Septuagint, which is basically the translation of the Torah into Koine Greek. So let's have a quick look at this unusual phenomenon. The legend associated with the translation is really quite fascinating. It dates back to the 3rd or possibly 2nd century before the Common Era, and it is recorded in classical Greek sources as well as rabbinic sources. And the legend basically goes, there are some variations, that King Ptolemy of Egypt wanted to produce a translation of the Torah, a great work of Jewish literature, for his library and presumably for the Jewish population of Alexandria, who may not have had a working knowledge of Hebrew. He commissioned from the high priest in Israel, again according to the legend, to have a number of scholars sent down to Alexandria where they would work on the translation. He received 72 scholars, representatives from each of the 12 tribes, and to ensure that the translation would be honest, he placed all of them in separate rooms and gave them a copy of the Torah and had them record their own translation. Amazingly, as the legend goes, a miracle occurred, and when they all came out of their separate rooms and compared their translations, they were all identical. There's a small comment on this by Rabbi Yitzchak Kuttner, who is reputed to have once said that you call that a miracle? That's not a miracle at all. You take 70 rabbis, put them all in one room, and see if they come out with the same translation. Now that's a miracle. But going back to the Septuagint, it was received very positively by the ancient Jewish community in Egypt, particularly by Philo, also pronounced Philo Judaeus, who was perhaps the most important proponent of Jewish thought in the Greek language and had a huge influence on Christian understandings of Judaism in the early, the ancient and in the medieval world, who viewed it very positively initially as a wonderful achievement of scholarship, making the Torah available in a vernacular of approximately the first century before the Common Era. Christian reception of the book was extremely important because, of course, the early Christians, particularly once you get past the first few generations who were born in Israel, had very little facility with the Hebrew original of the Torah. And as it became into greater use, and of course it was expanded upon not only from the 5 books of the Torah, but into the other books of the Bible, there were many very important elements in the translation which formed Christian theology. For example, translations of key passages in the book of Isaiah rendered the figure of Mary as a virgin, whereas the original text in the Hebrew uses the word Alma, which is generally meant to mean young woman, which is quite a very different translation. Later on, a few centuries later, Jerome performed a service for the scholarly world and for the clergy by translating the Bible into Latin. He had much more significant Hebrew skills, and as a result, he relied only partially on the Septuagint and, in fact, went back to the Hebrew translation, the Hebrew original, I should say, which resulted in much more fidelity to the original. For this, he was heavily criticized by St. Augustine, the church father, who felt that the Septuagint, even though it was ultimately a translation, nevertheless represented a Christological version of the Torah. Jewish reception is somewhat muted when you move outside of Philo's philosophical circles and Egypt in particular. The legends that are recorded in the Talmud speak of 13 distinct changes which the translators of the Septuagint, translators of the Torah into the Greek vernacular, enacted, primarily for various political and theological items on their agenda in order to make sure that the Torah would be appropriately received by its Greek readers. And as a result, the Septuagint has largely dropped out of the rabbinic tradition, even though it was performed under some level of duress. It was not considered one of the most authoritative renderings of the Torah, and as a result, it barely appears in most rabbinic literature, especially when you compare it to Aramaic translations like that of Unculus. And in fact, as Professor Moshe Simon Shoshan wrote in a very useful article, I've given you the title of it here and it is available on the web, the rabbis generally don't even use the word targum, which means translation, when they refer to the Septuagint. They prefer to use the term katav, which means writing, meaning the Septuagint was written as an original work of religious scholarship, as opposed to being a faithful translation of the Torah. This all fits within the larger scope of the discussion of the controversies over Bible and Talmud translations as a whole, which are beyond the scope of our discussion today. But I thank you very much for listening, and I hope you have an excellent week.